What's up, guys?
Hello, hello. I am here to tell you exactly what you need to be doing to make your own track and racetrack. Well, essentially, to fully get started, you're going to need about 5 different programs. 4 if you don't really want to get super technical with it. What you're going to be needing is obviously Racetrack Builder or 3DS Max, but I'm only going to be covering Racetrack Builder in this tutorial because that's what I personally use. You're also going to be needing KS Editor, which I will have a download for in the description below. A photo editing program of your choice. I personally use paint.net. It's a great program. It's not quite as good as Photoshop, which if you do have it and know how to use it, go ahead and use it. It's one of the better programs you could use. And you're also obviously gonna need WinRAR because making a track deals with a lot of archives and compressed files. So yeah, once you have those 5 programs, 4 again, if you don't really want to get super technical, you can get started. So, to actually get started making a track, essentially, there's quite a few little things that you're going to be needing to do. So, you want to start off by deciding, are you going to make a pre-existing track, or are you just going to make your own? And that's really what you should start by thinking. For the sake of this tutorial, I'm going to be making something that is pre-made, something in the real world. I believe this is in Saskatchewan? Yeah, this is Saskatchewan, in Canada. It's just a little track, and shouldn't be too hard to make. So to fully get started, what you're going to want to do is set up a Google API or a Google API account. To set up the Google API, you're going to want to go to this website. I will have the download link or the link to it in the description below. And you're just going to want to follow the instructions. Pretty simple to follow. Make an account, create a project page, create an API key. This one part is a bit tricky, so be really careful with it. And then you're just going to add a few different APIs. One of them is the Google Static Maps API. The other one is the Elevation Data API. And once you have those two, you're pretty much set. You're just going to want to make just some random thing that you're not going to be using. Go up to Edit. Then you go to RTB Settings and put the API code that you generate into this Google API thing and press OK. So now if I go to make a new track, there it is. You can now enter coordinates. In Google Maps, what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to go up to the fucking URL bar, and right after this at sign right here. So you're going to want to copy up to that comma right there so that you get 2 distinct coordinates. And then you're just going to want to highlight that and paste it in. And you're gonna press this Google button, so you can see that now we are it gives me something like this. So I can choose to zoom in really far in if I so choose, really far out if I want, but just know the bigger that or the further zoomed out you are, the longer it's gonna take to render, especially if it's a higher quality thing. So I'm not gonna really focus on, I guess I could just do this. So I'm gonna press OK. Because I have it set to very high, I know that it'll capture what I want it to. I'm going to press OK. So this is going to take a while to actually create it. You can see the progress, or you'll be able to see the progress on this little low bar right here. As you can see, it's going to take a very long time. So here we are on the track. So the basics of moving around in Racetrack Builder are as follows. You right click to rotate your camera left and right, up and down, anything of the sort. You scroll wheel to zoom in slowly, hold shift and then scroll to zoom in and out fast, then hold shift and right click to rotate around a certain point. So if I select up here, then I'll rotate around this point. If I select right here, I'll rotate around that point. So yeah, that's pretty much all there is to moving around. I believe you can also, yeah, you can hold the middle mouse button to drag as well, if that helps. To start out, there's the paint tool, which I'm not going to be using, but it just lets you paint the terrain, different textures, stuff like that. There's the add detail tool, which we are about to use. And then there's the remove detail or add terrain. So this tool, it would allow you to extend this out if you wanted to. Like if you had a big track and you needed mountains in the distance, this is the tool you'd be using to do that. So it's just pretty simple, just click and drag to actually get it to work. Highlight it or hover over it and press the delete key to delete. Alright, so what we're going to do is we're going to grab this circle subdivision tool. We're going to zoom all the way in. And then holding control, I'm going to bring my mouse to the left to close this circle down. And then I'm going to press W to see the wireframe. Very good. So if you want to have more detail, you just take this circle subdivision tool and you just run it right over the track. You can see it's dividing that big triangle up into very tiny triangles that we can use to add a lot more detail to the track. So you just want to run it over here. If you have anywhere that you want intense detail, like maybe on the track, you can do it even more, like so. Just know that it starts to take a while after a while, because it's a lot to process. That's the whole track, so you can see that's what it looks like without wireframe, that's what it looks like with wireframe. And if I were to zoom out, you can see that it goes, actually, it looks pretty cool. Alright, so that's all you really need to know about the terrain. There's a few different settings in the, alright, so next in the tracks. So this is basically where you're going to be spending most of your time when you're actually creating a track. It's where you're going to put the most amount of effort laying down tracks, adjusting them properly, etc., etc. It looks like this track is pretty thin, so I'm also going to be showing you how to narrow your track up. To lay down a track, you're going to go to here, add a new track, then click and drag, and that'll lay down your first piece of track. From there, you can just keep clicking every once in a while, and it will place down something called a node. These nodes are what control the actual curvature of your track. So you can see, leave wireframe. It can be a bit weird. And then to delete nodes, you just go to this move the nodes of the track, delete, click on it, and delete, 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 delete. So yeah. Yeah, I'm just going to delete all of this and restart. By default, all tracks start with a camber of 0.1. So if you want a flat track, then you need to turn that to 0. What camber does is it lowers the inner part of the track and raises the exterior part of the track. Just making it so that you can hit corners faster and feels nicer. But it's hard to work with in small corners like this, and it becomes really choppy and bumpy, and it's just annoying to deal with altogether, so I wouldn't recommend it on a track this small. So you normally want to keep your segments under 500. This number right here is the total length of the track. You could make it longer if you so chose. But like 1,000 meters is the absolute maximum. That's when collision stops working as well, and other stuff. So I'm just gonna go to the move tool so I can start moving these nodes around, make the track look like how I want it to. This part right here is kind of just getting a feel for it, and learning how everything connects together, how nodes kind of interpret tracks. It just takes a bit of getting used to. It's not too hard to learn though. That is weird though. So when you get too sharp of a corner, something like this happens. It kind of folds in on itself. And to fix this, you normally just want to bring it out a little more. In this case, I don't think that's entirely possible. So what I'm going to do is, instead of making this one node the apex, I'm going to move it to the side and make it a dual apex, which is just something like this. So you can see it still somewhat fits the curvature of the track. So now for the second part of the track, I'm going to go to add a new track, and then I'm just going to go off of there, and then I'm going to click and drag this last part, and you'll see this little yellow thing. And then you just let go of it when you see that yellow, and it will connect the two segments of the track. So I'm going to do that here as well. To have that work, you need to have this join tracks thing selected or clicked like that. I'm also going to remove the camber from there. All right. So, as you can see here, we got a little kind of bump that I don't exactly want to have. So to fix something like this is something I can actually show you pretty easily, because it's one of the next things that we are going to talk about, which is working with nodes. To raise or lower the elevation of a node, you hold Y and click and drag. And that will only raise or lower it. Like, I'm trying to move the mouse all over right now, it's not doing anything. So you could have it super deep underground or super high up, and the terrain will always come to match it as long as you have that selected. Or as long as you have the, what is it? The terrain normal and the grounded thing selected. So that looks pretty decent. You can see that we got some nice rolling hills here. It's got a bit of elevation. Actually looks like a kind of fun track. So that's the two basic tools, the ones you're mainly going to be using. What we're going to look into next is the cross sections, otherwise known as splines. And these are little orange bars, that control the height of individual segments of the track. So you can see if I move this super high up, this entire track segment is going to be raised from right there. So because this is a close quarters track and I don't really need any other elevation fixes, like I'm not going to be working with too insane elevation. And also because you can see that this part kind of gets cut out, meaning that can't go. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go to these two nodes on the end and I'm going to delete them on either side, so that the edge of the track is the actual edge of the track. What you'll see now, I need to do the other track as well. I'm just going to want to do that for both of them. And you can see if I remove nodes on this part, it removes the nodes there as well on the other end of the track. So you don't need to do it twice. So yeah, you can see now that this track is now back. To shorten the track, you just go to this blue arrow and move it in. This is how you actually narrow or widen the track, but be careful because it can also go up or down. So you have to be fairly precise. Now, to actually go about aligning them properly, what I'm going to do is I'm going to click and drag all of these nodes in the middle. I'm going to make a circle around it so it selects them all, and I'm going to delete them, both of these. And that'll flatten the track out. That'll make it so that it's completely flat, but it'll also make it bumpy, which is not quite what I want. But currently, I just need to do that so I can line the tracks up properly so there isn't going to be a bump there. The thing is, if you're going to shorten a track, you do need to do it on both sides, because this is now going to be regular size, that's now really thin. But let's just leave it like that, because why not, right? Now, to re-add those nodes that we deleted, because we do want them back, you just select the thing, press control, and just keep clicking. And you can select the distances, like I can make them every little bit if I wanted to, but that would be awful. And that would be that would take too long to load. So I'm just gonna add them roughly about a meter or a foot apart-ish. Be careful not to like accidentally lift it or something while you're doing that, because I've done that before and it's a pain in the ass. But yeah, so once you have all of that done, you're just gonna press Control S to save, or you can go up to File, Save. So now let's hop into track cutting. So this is what happens when you have something like this, where you have one track segment, but then there's another, and you wanna get it to flow properly into it. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna go back to the terrain creator or the track, what is this called? Add new track tool. Alright, that's good. And I'm just going to click and drag from that, and I'm just going to make this one little segment. To start out, I'm going to go into the spline, or into the cross section. I'm going to delete the sides, because that part is especially important for crossing tracks over, otherwise there'd be a whole split down the middle here. Then I'm also gonna delete all the cross sections in the middle, just to make it easy. I'm going to shorten this up on both sides so it actually fits properly. There we go. And then I'm gonna go up here to the move the nodes of the track, and I'm gonna select cut by track. So for this one, I'm also gonna need to go up here and select cut track. And what that'll do, you can see it actually cut the track. So now it looks smooth. But you'll notice that there's a little bump here, and there's probably one on this side too. Yeah, it's something like that. That's because there's an elevation difference. So what we need to do is we need to go select this one, and we need to modify the cross sections. So if you see, there's like the edge of the track, the very, like the side that you're moving, you want it to line up directly, like as close as you can to the edge of the track. And that'll make it nice and smooth. And I'm just gonna do that for this part as well, although this one's a bit harder to judge. Let's put it right about there. And that looks good. Although now that's gonna be up, there's not much I can do. So so say I wanted it to go the other way, you know, say I wanted this corner to get cut by this straight line. What I would do is I would then go to this, I'd say I'd select cut track, and I'd select this one to be cut by track, but you can see still nothing happens, and that's because of a little thing called hierarchy. So you can see right here, right underneath camber, it says hierarchy. And for this straight line, it says 2, and for this track, it says 0. So the lower the number, the higher in the hierarchy it is. So if it's a 0, then nothing can cut through it. It will cut everything that's cuttable. So if I wanted to change it, I'd make this one 2, and I'd make this one 1. So now you can see it's cutting the other way. It looks awful, but that's what it does. So yeah, I'm just gonna undo that though, because I don't want to be doing that. So yeah, that's basically all there is to making, like putting down tracks. Although say you wanted your own texture, like you have your own track texture that you want, and you can very easily do that by selecting this change the materials tool, and it'll bring up this little thing. All you really need to know is that these little arrows let you select a specific thing. So say you wanted to do concrete too, you would just select it there and then click and drag it onto the track. You can see that changes it to the atrocious looking concrete too, which actually kind of hurts my eyes. So I'm just gonna undo that because I don't want it to look like that. So that's really all there is to making or putting down tracks. So it's fairly simple. It takes a bit of getting used to, but it's not the hardest thing in the world. Alright, now we're going to dive into objects. Stuff like trees and poles, cones, buildings, etc., etc. There's not too much to know here, it's just good to know. Under the tab objects, under this, you can add a single object, straight line, or lasso. There's also the move tool, as there is with most things. And then this little drop down menu, which will let you select whatever object you want. Like say I wanted to put down, where's the trees? Okay, I don't have trees apparently. Let's just put down like a grandstand or a potty. For the single object, it's pretty self-explanatory. All there really is, just click and it'll pop in. It'll have this little outline where you can go to the move existing objects and move it around. Important things to note, if something is too big, then you can very easily change its size by holding the S button, clicking on whatever face you want to resize, and move to the right to make it bigger, move to the left to make it smaller. So say I wanted it to be super small or like flat, just move it way left, or maybe I wanted it to be super tall. You know, I could just do that. And you could do this with all three faces. So I can make a telephone booth there. That's weird. Yeah, so that's really that. Same thing goes for rotating. You just hold the R button and moving to the left is counterclockwise, moving to the right is clockwise, and you can do this for all the vertices or all the faces. So yeah, it's actually a pretty helpful tool. For the straight line tool, it's pretty self-explanatory as well. Just click and drag and it'll create a straight line of these things. When you're done, they'll all be selected. So if you have a modification you want to do to all of them, like say rotate them all, just hold R and it'll rotate all of them. And then finally for the lasso tool, which is really useful for putting stuff down like trees, which I could show you if I had trees. So essentially it's similar to selecting stuff. You're just going to want to make a general outline by clicking and holding, clicking and dragging of where you want them to be put down, and let go once you've finished. And it'll make a rough outline of randomly placed objects in that area. So you can see I made like a little wave type thing here. I'm not going to keep that though. It's pretty simple. So with objects, the way that you add new things, it's a little something called X-Packs. So let me just get that open. So say you wanted to add an X-Pack, alright? You would go to Racetrack Builder, then you'd find the track that you're working on, this is tutorials, and then you'd go into X-Packs, and you can see I have like two X-Packs here. For my main track, Stratotech, if I were to go into the X-Packs, you can see I have many, many ones here. Let's see, 10 times. I'll copy that. And let's bring it into tutorial just to show it off. So you just want to paste it. Don't uncompress it. Just leave it as it is. And hopefully it should just pop up, which it doesn't look like it will. So to actually get it to take effect, you want to save and then restart. Alright, so so now you can see if I were to go in here, there's a little thing called road signs, and it has all the little the signs that I made. So I could go and put it down, like say that's a left turn. Or actually, I'll do a left U-turn. So if I put it down here and rotated it, because orientation is stupid with this, you can see that that is now a road sign, although it's a bit big. So what I tend to do is hold Y and just lower it, and that's a bit better. So now we'll move on to string objects. With string objects, you have to be careful because they're really processor intensive, and they can cause your map to not load into KS Editor, which is the program I'll be showing you after this, once you're done with them. So the kind of string objects you want to stay away from are these main ones, these guardrails right here, because they have a tendency of being super, super processor intensive, and they just won't load. Like, even if you put one or two of them down, they're just horrible to use. So what I tend to use is I go to the concrete walls, and I use one of these two, mainly this one. So yeah. When it comes to string objects, you don't really need the straight line very often, nor do you need the freehand draw, but if you wanted to like put grass down or something, then those two might be helpful. What I mainly use is the curve, and I'll show you why I love it. It's because I can now go like this. I can click and drag to start it out. I can just put some nodes around, make it look nice. Like that, but you can see it's not very, actually it's pretty accurate, but it's not entirely accurate. It's a bit bumpy. It's like it doesn't fully match the corners. What I can do is I can go to move existing objects, I can hold A, and then I can click and drag one of the nodes, and it'll auto align it for me. The entire thing will auto align to the edge of the corner, based on how many nodes you've used. It doesn't work for every corner, mind you. It's a bit buggy, but it's a really helpful tool to use. Like, you can actually see it didn't fully work with this one. This side's a little further out than this one is. But it's still really helpful and it saves a lot of time. And finally, we have the grid and, like, race stuff, which is weird. I don't fully understand all of that stuff. But as you can see, there's the start line right here, which you can move around just by clicking and dragging these two little cars. So I would start there. And then you can move this around by holding the yellow car. I have no clue what this orange one does, but I always just keep it nearby these. I'm pretty sure it's this, like, the pit car or the lead car or something. But this blue and purple one is the one that you're actually going to be spawning with if you bring this into multiplayer. This is where the actual cars will spawn, so just bear that in mind. And so I can guarantee that if I were to load it to practice, I'd load on this purple car right here. As for the rest, these are kind of just checkpoints, checkpoint one, checkpoint two. I don't really pay much attention to these because I make drift tracks, I don't make race tracks, but they're fairly simple to point out. Just start is finish, and as far as I know, you can't make a point-to-point race and have it set. Oh, never mind. Yes, you can. That's funny. So, say you load into the track, like, in a set of course, and it's all dark. Venue, or edit, venue, and then you'll see this. So, if you click anywhere on the sun, it'll show up, or it'll correlate to where the sun is in the sky. So if I wanted it to be like super nighttime, I would go like that. If I wanted it to be midday, I'd bring it to the middle. You can see it gets brighter. Or maybe I wanted it to be like a nice little sunrise type situation. So I believe the sun would be like right there. I can change the intensity of it as well. And then materials, you don't really need to go in here too often, but if you do need to, there's a few different things here. You're probably not going to need this, so I'm not going to go into it. Then, finally, X-Packs. You can just select what X-Packs you would like to be using. So, yeah. So, now that you've got your amazing track, in my case, a total shit track, you need to go about exporting it from Racetrack Builder. And to do that, you just go to File, you go to Export, and you leave everything default, and you just press OK. And then it just exports. If it's a bigger track, it'll take longer. Don't be clicking anything else, just for fear of it getting corrupted. But once you see these coordinates in the top left start to move again, if you move your mouse, then it's done. What that did, though, is if I were to go to the actual, where is it? If I were to go to Racetrack Builder and go to Tutorial, now there's a file here called Export, which I can go into. And it has an FBX and an FBX.ini along with all the textures I've used. So the FBX.ini just kind of lists all the materials that were used. So the tarmac, the background, the portaloo, the signs, etc., metal, stuff like that. But the FBX is what actually interests you, because it's what you're actually going to bring into KS Editor. So I'm just going to close out of this, and now I will load up KS Editor. So the link to KS Editor will also be in the description below if you need it. So to go about importing your track into KS Editor, so for KS Editor, these are the basics. To import, you go to File, you go to Open FBX, and then you locate the location that it exported to from Racetrack Builder. So in my case, that's right here. And you just select this tutorial.fbx and open it. And it'll import. For bigger tracks, again, it'll take longer. For smaller tracks, it won't. To go about moving around in KS Editor, you use the arrow keys to move forward, left, back, and right. You hold left click and move around to look around, and then you hold control and the arrow keys to move fast. And that's really all you need to know. You can also zoom in, but that changes your FOV, and we'll actually be using that later. Let's say that you made a really big track. It's got a lot of trees, a lot of string objects. You gotta load it in, and it doesn't load. The issue with that is you have too many objects, or too many high resolution objects, or too many string objects, which are really processor intensive. That's why you gotta be careful, because it just won't load into KS Editor, and you'll have to cut back on a few things. It's a pain in the ass, but like it's nothing you can do about that. So let's see. One of the main things you do in KS Editor is you add collision to walls or to rubble strips or anything of the sorts, or signs. And to go about doing that, you just right click on the object that you want to add collision to, and it'll just bring you up. So under this, there's a little thing that says name. And what you're gonna wanna do is you're gonna wanna change the name of this inner object to one capital wall underscore barrier or something. I normally just do bar. And then now, if I were to export this, this wall would have collision. And then I can go to, can you fucking select? There we go. So you can see this this one's name is object 2. Just gonna change that to one wall, one wall underscore pole. Another thing you can be doing in KS Editor is you can be changing the illumination. You can also do it in Racetrack Builder, but some people prefer to do it in KS Editor, because you can actually see the sun. So the angle just kind of chooses what angle it is in the sky. So if I wanted it to be a sunset, I just put the angle higher, or sunset on the other side, put it lower, you know. This just, like, if I wanted it to be high noon, I'd have the angle at 1, whoops, and so on and so forth. I'll leave it about right there. It just chooses where it is in the sky, depending on the time of the year, I guess. Just play around with those settings until you find something you like. I'll just say that's good. You can also change the cloud cover, cloud cutoff, etc., etc., etc. Now I'll be showing you guys how you're going to go about creating your track map and track cameras using an AI path, otherwise known as a Fastlane underscore AI. To start this out, what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to find your set of Corsa, or wherever it's located. I believe mine is settings. Where am I going? City maps, common, set of Corsa. So now that you're here, you're going to want to go into system, CFG, and then this first file is seto underscore corsa.ini. I want to open that up. And then right here where it says enable dev apps, you're going to want to change this from a 0 to a 1. And then file, save. So this will allow you to use certain, certain plugins, if you will, that you wouldn't normally be able to use if you were, if you didn't have that checked. One of those being the Assetto Corsa AI manager, which actually lets you record the thing. So once this is done loading, I'll get to showing you what to do. So I'm gonna load up the tutorial real quick and show you exactly what you need to be doing. All right, so once you've gotten into game, you're gonna want to go to the right side of the screen with your mouse and scroll down until you find this AI. It looks like a guy next to a computer with a helmet on it. You're gonna open that up and then find out where you want to start your AI path and what direction you want it to follow. I'm gonna start it up here at the start of this little part because I want my clock to go counterclockwise.
The handbrake lever is connected directly to a girl's sexual apple.
So, what you're going to want to do is just stop, and then you're going to click Start Pits, Start Recording. You're going to want to run a slow lap of the whole track. So, you don't need to drift it or anything, just stay relatively in the middle of the track. Make sure it's a nice smooth line,
that you're not being jagged or anything. So I'll see you once I've done a full lap. All right, so now that you've finished your lap, you have the AI stop where you want it to stop. You're going to press this little recording button to stop the recording, as this one right here doesn't stop. And then you're just going to want to exit. You don't need to press the save AI button. That does something different. Just want to leave. That's all we really need to be doing in Assetto Corsa for this part. Now we're going to go to, we're going to go to content. We're going to go to tracks. And we're going to go to the track that we're making. And you'll see now that if I go into this AI, we have something called a pit_lane.ai.candidate. So we're going to rename this and remove the candidate part. And we're going to change pit to fast. Just like that. It'll say this, just press yes. So now that is our fastlane.ai. That's what tells Assetto Corsa which way the track is supposed to be running. And it also connects to other stuff. So now that we have that, we're going to go into KS Editor. Just need to load it up real quick. So now that we have KS Editor loaded, we need to open the FBX of the track that, no, not that, of the track that we've made. So for me, it's tutorial.fbx, open, and now we're here. So this is the track. As you can see, it's extremely basic. Again, it's kind of shitty. Then we're going to go to AI Spline and load. And then we're going to go find the Assetto Corsa folder. So I'm going to just go into my thing right here and copy the path just to make it easy on myself and paste. So I'm going to go into this AI and open this fastlane_ai that we, or fast_lane.ai that we just created. And you'll see that exactly where I just drove is now a pink line. So you see I started from right here, and then I went all the way around, and I stopped right there. This is how you make track cameras with this actual AI spline. This is where the game decides what route the cameras are going to follow and how it knows to follow your car based on where you are. So to actually go about making track cameras, you're going to go to this little track cameras thing down here. And then you're going to put your, or position your camera where you want this first camera to be. So I'm going to have it be, say right here, but I'm going to zoom in nice and far so it looks like that. Then I'm going to press add here. So I'm going to set the in point to 0. And the out point, I'm not going to set that yet, but I'm going to name it start, or S, or start. I'm going to change this minimum value right here to 12 because 9 is a bit too zoomed in. Then I'm going to change the maximum to 40 because that's about right there. That's right about how much I want it to be. And then what I'm going to do is I can move now, so I'm just going to go ahead and do that. Right around where you want the camera to end, where you think the car is going to be cut off from view or where you want to cut it off from view. You're going to go to there on this AI path, and you're going to right-click close to the AI, or close to the path. It'll create this yellow pillar. That is, that's that. And then you're going to press this set out button. So that sets the out point for this camera. As you can see, it's now 0.26 blah, blah, blah. So, and then it creates this whole part to be a blue line. And so that's from the start. Let's see, I want. So yeah. Now it's time to make the next camera. So I'm gonna just put it right here because, yeah, that's good enough. Or actually, I'll move to the side of it. So now I'm just gonna press refresh to actually save all those changes. And I'm gonna press add here. And I'm gonna go and rename this to Cam1. And I'm going to press the set in button because we want this camera to come in where the last one ended. And then I'm just going to keep the maximum and the minimum. We're actually going to change the minimum to 20 because I don't want that much. I'll change that to 30. And then I'm going to set the out point to right about there. It's not always precise, but that's close enough. Press set out and then refresh. And I'm just going to keep doing this for the rest of the track. So say you want it to be a fixed camera, you know, like say there was a jump or there's normally a lot of action. I know there isn't right here, but just to show you how it works, we're going to add here. You normally want it to be close to the ground. You're going to set the endpoint right there. Then underneath this little fixed part, right above the end, you're going to change that to true. And so I'm going to change this minimum to 15th and maximum to 30. Then I'll change the out point to right about here. Yeah, right about there. And I'll press set out. Now, camera will be in a fixed position. Let me just name that real quick. Cam 2, refresh. If I double click this, this is what the camera's gonna see. You're gonna see the car come through here, and it's gonna get cut off right after it gets past the camera. So if I wanted, now I can go zoom out a little, and I can set it to be like this. I can go add here, unnamed. I'm gonna set this one to be a fixed as well. Set that to be set in. Make that the out point. So out, cam 3. I'll finish up the rest of these real quick, and hopefully that will be sped up.
For the last camera, what you're going to want to do is once you find where you want it to actually be, you're going to set the endpoint, you're going to rename it to finish. You don't have to do that part, but I like to. You're going to change the FOV to something that you want, maybe 20. Then what you're going to do for the out point, you're going to set it to 1. If you remember, we started at 0, and now we're going to 1. And if you've been paying attention, the further like along the spline or the AI path that we get, the closer to 1 this gets. And this will just say to the end of the AI path right there. So let's see, is there anything else? Oh, refresh. All right, there we go. Now we have track cameras there. So to export these, we're just gonna go to here, gonna go to save, and then we're not gonna go in the AI, we're gonna go in the data, and we're just gonna name it cameras, and then save. And so now if we go and check in the tutorial, if we look in the data, we now have a cameras.ini. Okay, so now I'm going to reload into Assetto Corsa and create a track map, which can only be done with this AI path that we just created. What it does is it takes the AI path that we created and it turns it into an actual image, something that we can see. It just auto does it for us, which is great. I love that feature. But we're going to go to Drive. And then we're going to go to tutorial. I believe this is tutorial. Yeah, it should be. I'm going to press start. All right, so now we're in here. And because I have the AI thing still open, you can still see the AI path that we created. And it looks a bit rougher in Assetto Corsa, but yeah. So what I'm going to do, because I don't need it anymore, I'm just going to go turn this off because it's bothered. Now, I'm going to run a nice lap just to give you guys an idea of what the replay will look like. Although, before I do, if you look in this top corner right here, you can see that we now have this track map. We have the just have an outline of what the track should look like. I'll run a quick lap and show you guys what this track cameras look like.
So excuse my awful run. It's my first. Like, I haven't played this out, of course, all day. Now if I go into the replays, under camera 7, this is what it looks like. Just about it. So that's how you make an AI path, or a fastlane.ai, how you make track cameras, and how you make the track map.
Alright. Okay, so you've got all the walls have collision, the sun's where you want it, etc., etc. There's a few other things you could do here, but I'm not going to show them just yet, at least. And now you just need to export it. So you go up to File, you save CAN 5, and you select track. And then you're just going to want to name it whatever you want it to be named. Just make sure it's all lowercase, because instead, of course, it doesn't like capitals when it comes to track making. It's just all around easier. So file name tutorial, save. And then it'll say save. So what that did is it saved a KN5 file. And that's the actual, that's everything you just did compressed into one file. You can see the biggest file here, because it also has all the textures and all the information. So, now we get to go about actually organizing the track folder. Actually making it so that other people could just download it, uncompress it, and hop on. So, to go about doing that, what we're going to do is I'm just going to get to my tracks folder. I'm going to make a new track called Tutorial. So it's a bit daunting to start out, because you really don't know what to do. You look in all these other ones and they have like 3K5 things, a bunch of different files and folders. All you need is these five. You need an AI file, a data file, a UI file, and a map. You don't even need the map.png, but it's good to have it. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna select this all, I'm gonna copy, and I'm gonna paste it in my tutorial. Whoops, what the fuck have I done? Oh, I've opened it all, have I? Okay. So I'm going to delete this, I'm going to delete that, I'm going to delete, well, I guess I can keep the outline there. So there's no AI in there, the data, I'm just going to, I'm going to keep the surfaces, I can delete the map, delete the lighting, I can delete the cameras, but I'm going to save the crew. The crew and the surfaces, because these two just, the crew.ini decides what side of your car the little guy with the flagpole is going to be standing on when you load it. I have it set to the left side at the current moment. The surfaces defines surfaces. It defines what grass is, what the roads are, like the tracks, and what friction they'll be. A really good friction to use is 1.0. Some people use 1.1. Other people use 0.8, but that feels like driving on ice, so yeah, just be wary, it's really touchy. So then there's the UI, and this is the outline.png is the actual outline you'll see when you're looking at the track from Assetto Corsa. Like, when you're just trying to pick a track, that's the file, or that's the outline of the track you'll be seeing. The preview.png is the same thing. It's just the background to the outline. What we're concerned about here in getting the track ready is this UI underscore track JSON, which I'm going to open up. And yeah, actually, I'm not going to do that just yet. First, I'm going to be taking this CAN5 file we just extracted or exported. I'm going to put it right in there. And I'm also going to be copying exactly what I've named it there. And I'm going to go into the UITrack.json. I'm going to paste it there. Letter for letter, capital for capital. No difference there whatsoever. And I'm going to click save, close it. And I'm also going to go here, rename, paste it, even though it's the same. Those three things right there, the track name, the CAN5 name, and the name in the UITrack.json need to be the exact same. Otherwise, it just messes up, and it's fucking annoying. All right, so in the AI folder, there's a little file called a fast_lane.ai that you could make. I'll be showing how to make that in a different video. The link will maybe be in the description once I have it up. And it's what you use to make track cameras, and it also keeps people going the proper way on the track. It's annoying to deal with, but it's necessary sometimes. It's also how you make the track map. So that is basically all you really need to know to make your track, the basics at least. So now I can just load up Content Manager, and we'll test this track out.
Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I hope it can be a helpful resource to anybody looking to get into track making that just watched it. Track I made isn't quite as good as it could have been because I didn't really put that much effort into it. I was just trying to make it for a tutorial. But obviously, with the tools I showed you, you can make something insanely awesome. Thanks for watching.